Why don't we stand and open us prayer? Praise God. We welcome everyone, those present and those at home. Pray that if you're watching, you can worship at home, and we're going to worship this evening. I was going to say this morning, but it's this evening. Praise the Lord. We welcome every one of you. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord. Father, we come with thanksgiving this evening, Lord, to the house of God. Even physically, Lord, it's nice and cool. But in you, Lord, we find refreshments for our soul, Father. You refresh us. You strengthen our souls. Because in you, Father, we have hope. And Father, this evening we come seeking you. This evening also we lift up Pastor Mike, that you touch him, you heal our pastor. Others that are going through afflictions in their lives. Brother Carlos, Father, we pray that you touch him. Sister Annie, Lord, thank you that you have touched her. She's in our midst. And many others, Father, that are going through difficult times, we pray that you extend your hand of mercy upon them. We pray that you give them a touch. You strengthen them. Encourage them by your Holy Spirit, Lord. And Father, this evening, we just want to worship you. We want to worship you and ask that you touch every one of our lives. We pray and put this meeting in your hands. We pray in Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. Oh, he is good. He's above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise with a mighty hand.
Lost it.
power. Death has lost its sting. From the grave you've risen victoriously. Into marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame. By the cross you are the truth, you are the light, you are the way. Stains now clean. Your breath fills up my lungs. Now I'm free. Now I'm free. My dead heart now is beating. My deepest stains now clean. Your breath fills up my lungs. Now I'm free. Now I'm free. Sin has lost its power. Death has lost its sting. From the grave you've risen victoriously. Into marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame. By the cross you are the truth, you are the light, you are the way. Into marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame. By the cross you are the truth, you are the life, you are the way, Lord. You are the way, oh Lord. You are the truth. You are the way. Tonight, Father, we just want to settle our hearts to you and we just want to make room for you, Lord, tonight. We need you. We just invite you here tonight in our hearts, in this room tonight, in our minds. Have your way.
You want to, I will make room, and I will
will make room for you, Lord, to do whatever you want to, Jesus. Do whatever you want to, I will make room, and I will make room for you, Lord, to do whatever you want to, whatever you want to. Shake up the ground of all my tradition. Break down the walls of all my religion. Your way is better. Your way is better. Shake up the ground of all my tradition. Break down the walls of all my religion. Your way is better. Shake up the ground of all my tradition. Break down the walls of all my religion. Your way is better. Your way is better, Lord. Shake up the ground of all my tradition. Break down the walls of all my religion. Your way is better. Your way is better. Want to, Lord, help us wherever you want to, and I will make room for you. Do whatever you want to, Lord, wherever you want to, and I will make room. Every burden, every crown, well, this is my surrender, and this is my surrender. Here is where I lay it down, every lie and every doubt. This is my surrender, this is my surrender.
In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Why don't we greet somebody tonight? Thank you. Sister Christine's running around doing a bunch of stuff back there. Thank you for doing all that. Thank you for serving. Amen. We appreciate everybody that serves. Everybody that serves, thank you guys. Welcome this evening. There's some announcements. So Saturday morning is prayer. Doors open at 7:30. This coming Sunday, we're going to be praying for all the kids and young people that are going to school. So, you know, if you have kids or grandkids and you can bring them, or if you're watching online, you know, bring them to church Sunday. And we're just going to ask the Lord's blessings over them. You know, they need God's protection physically, mentally, spiritually, emotionally. And they just need God's grace. So we're going to pray over them. Also, the Quakes Family Fellowship Night is coming up. That's August 23rd. So you could still sign up over there, and there's information over there. And also the Women's Retreat, September 6th, 7th, and 8th. So sign-ups are still going on. Kathy, is there a deadline on that? An end line? No? Okay. So just keep signing up. Excellent. Very exciting. And also next Tuesday is Men and Women's Bible Study on the 1st. On the 6th. Okay, you know why? Because I'm reading July's. So I'm a month behind. I don't know if you ever feel like that, like you're just behind. But, like, so anyways, yeah. So thank you. So on the 6th, so next Tuesday, 6 p.m. Excellent. Brother Louis prayed for our pastor tonight, Pastor Mike, and he's down resting right now. And he has these struggles with severe migraines, and he really wanted to be here. So I know he's praying for us, and his heart's here. So we're going to pray right now, and then we'll get into the Word. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity just to worship you and honor you, Lord. And it's because of who you are, and you're worthy of it. We thank you. We thank you again, like we prayed earlier for Pastor Mike, that you would touch him and heal him, and also Sister Susan. And bless them, God. Be with them tonight. Encourage them. Thank you for the good news of Jackie and Nathan's baby being born healthy, and little Ezra. Thank you for that awesome news. May you bless them, give them rest, and help them to get into a good family rhythm, and bless little Brooklyn, Lord. And we pray, Lord, also for Pastor Mike's friend, Vincent's family, the gentleman that passed away this past week. His wife and kids, Lord, as they get ready for the funeral. And we don't know if they know you or not, Lord, but if there's opportunity to minister to them, we just pray for open doors. Pray you touch them, Lord. You care about these people, Lord, and you know them. We just pray for them tonight. And we ask you, Lord, that you would also bless our time in your Word. And we invite you to have your way tonight. And all of Jesus' people pray. Amen. Amen. What's it worth? What's it worth? What is it worth? The cost of commitment can be a high price to be committed to something. In Mark chapter 8, verse 34. Actually, look at verse 31, starting there. Jesus was teaching. He says, he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed after 3 days. His commitment to his purpose was costly. It cost a lot. And he describes it there in verse 32. He spoke this word openly, and then Peter took him aside and started rebuking him. But when he had turned around and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter, saying, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are not mindful of the things of God, but the things of men." I think he's telling Peter, you're not going to distract me from my purpose, from my commitment, from what God has for me to do, why I'm here on this earth. Have you ever asked yourself that? Why am I here? Why am I here? Why did God put me here? And if you asked Jesus and said, "Jesus, why are you here on the earth? Like, why are you here? What's your purpose?" Verse 31 is what he said. I'm here to suffer, to be rejected, to be killed, and to rise from the dead. Can you imagine, like, knowing your purpose like that? Like, wow. And to go through with it, that's a huge amount of commitment. And then so he tells Peter, he's all, man, don't distract me. Don't tell me those things. You're not going to change my mind. You don't even know where what you're saying is coming from. It's not coming from the right place. It's coming from Satan. So in verse 34, he turns it to those that want to follow him. And he says, now when he had called the people to himself with his disciples also, he said to them, whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. So Jesus turns it around and he's like, hey, you guys want to follow me? He's all, you need to go the way I'm going. And denying yourself, dying to yourself, the way of the cross. Whoever desires to save his life will lose it. If you seek to save your life, to live for yourself, in the end, you're going to lose everything. You know, we live in a world and in a culture that's not very others-oriented. It's very self-oriented. It's like, you know, everybody needs to give in to what I want, what I believe, what I need. And I don't care about what it does to everybody else. It's the most important person on this planet is me. And that's a very natural way to think, aside from Christ, who said, I was sent for you to live and to suffer and then die for you so that you can live. We're weird people, man. Like, that's the right way. That's the way that's been from the beginning. But in this world that we live in, we just, that doesn't fit in, that mindset, that mentality. Every day and every little thing, you know, like, you took my spot, you're taking my peace, the way you looked at me, you disrespect, all these things. It's me, me, me. Why am I doing everything? Why am I working so hard when others are just getting away with nothing? Why are they getting this and I don't get nothing? Me, me, me. Me, I'm suffering. Regis is suffering. Regis is not getting his fair share of stuff, his fair share of whatever he thinks he's supposed to get. Anybody ever feel that way? So Jesus says, he knows we feel that way. Otherwise, he wouldn't have to say this. He's all, verse 36, for what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? What's it worth? Verse 37, or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? What's it worth? What is your soul worth? What is your purpose worth? Your being, who God made you to be, your life, your why you're here. What's it worth? Here Jesus was using a very practical example and said, what profit is it? If somebody has the whole world, if they have everything at their fingertips, everything that they want to satisfy themselves, it could be evil stuff and it could be stuff that's not evil. I mean, money, not evil. It could be, you know, just relaxation. It could be whatever, right? He said, but what does it matter if you get everything you want and you're so self-focused, but in the end, you were so self-focused, you didn't follow Christ and lay your life down for him and for others. So that's kind of heavy. Let's look at 1 Kings chapter 21. I love this illustration of what happened in 1 Kings chapter 21. King David, we haven't got there yet. Pastor Mike's going to be covering that. King David's going to die. We've been saying the life of David. He's going to be passing away. And he's going to go be with the Lord in heaven. And some years, time later, the kingdom of Israel is divided into two lands, Israel, which is 10 tribes to the north, and Judah, which is two tribes down in Bethlehem area.
And there's going to be different sets of kings and all kinds of kings. Some good, and most kings that serve Israel and Judah are bad. And in this chapter is one of the baddest dudes. He's just not a great leader. He's not a great king. He's very self-oriented. And there's a cost to it. He's committed to himself. But there's another guy, the hero of this chapter, a humble person that we really don't know a lot about. And he's committed also. And it costs him a lot. But he does it anyways. I hope this message will encourage us tonight to know that as we look at these verses, we'll see that it kind of feels like the day and age that we live in today. Hard. Just hard times. Difficult. Challenging. It challenges our commitment to our faith. It challenges our commitment to loving God and to loving others and to being committed to long-range things, eternity, the favor of God, and instead focusing on very temporary self things at times. So the person we're looking at is Naboth. And in chapter 21, it says this, and there's five things that we're gonna look at and just kind of skim over. It is one, value. What has value to you? What has value to you? And two is surrender. Surrender. What are you willing to surrender? And three, battle. There is a battle in our lives every day. Warfare going on. And it's not always seen, but there's warfare. And number four, this is the encouraging part, is God sees it all. God sees it all. Listen, I want to ask you something. In your life, the things that you go through, the sacrifices that you make, the faith that you hold on to, the commitment that you have. I'm not talking about when we fail. We all have failures. We have sins that we have. There's things that I'm talking about when you overcome by God's grace. When something goes right, and you're like, wow, you know, I did that, and I felt like God put that in my heart, and I did that thing, right? I didn't get angry with that person. All those things, whatever it is, loving your kids, loving your wife, your husband, serving. If you didn't know that God saw all that, if you didn't know that He is aware of all those things, would it be worth it? It wouldn't be worth it to me. It would not be worth it to me. I know that sounds awful, but really the thing is that keeps me going, that's greater than an earthly love, greater than being a dad to my kids, greater than just, you know, I got to be committed, is knowing that I have a God, a heavenly Father that sees His Son. And when by His grace I get it right, He sees all that. He knows. He's like, man, I saw that. That was awesome. That keeps me going. I have that hope. I have that hope that by His grace, when we're called either by rapture or by death, that He's going to say at the judgment seat, because of Christ in my life and commitment to Him, He's not going to say, man, I saw all your faults and failures and everything that you did wrong, Regis. I mean, those are there and God sees, and we need to deal with those things. We need to surrender those things. We need to look to Him and say, Lord, help me. And we're going to see that tonight. But that's not what He's going to bring up. He's going to bring up, well done. You know that one time when you did that thing and you gave that thing, and I'd be like, Lord, I don't even remember. Like, what thing, cup of water to what? So yeah, that person, you know, hearing and be like, man, Lord, I didn't imagine. He's all, you did it in my name. That was awesome. Good job. That time that you went and visited that person and they were sick and nobody knew about it and you don't even really feel like they appreciated it, but you did it because you love me and you have faith that I see you. So, man, that was like you were visiting me that day. Thank you so much. Good job. A God that sees. And then the fifth thing is there is grace for the humble. This chapter ends like, what? Seriously? You're going to show grace to somebody that doesn't deserve it? To the worst, one of the worst kings in Israel? I wouldn't have. I would have just struck him dead. I'd be like, oh, he's evil. But there is grace for the humble. So those five things. So let's jump into it and see what happens. Chapter 21. And it came to pass after these things that Naboth the Jezreelite had a vineyard which was in Jezreel next to the palace of Ahab, king of Samaria. So Ahab spoke to Naboth, saying, give me your vineyard that I may have it for a vegetable garden, because it is near next to my house. And for it, I will give you a vineyard better than it. Or, if it seems good to you, I will give you its worth in money. Value. Here, King Ahab, who in the scripture is described as being one of the most evil kings in the land of Israel, is living in Samaria, and next to his palace, because Samaria is towards the north, next to his palace, there's a vineyard, and it belongs to Naboth. And so Ahab is like, man, that's convenient. It's like right next to my palace, and I want that land. And so he goes to Naboth, and he's the king. He has power. He has money and wealth, and he's the king. He has authority. And he goes to Naboth, this guy that we really don't know a whole lot about, and we don't find out a whole lot about. Kind of like just an underdog, an unknown person, just a humble person living their life. And he goes to Naboth and says, hey, I saw your vineyard from my palace. He's all, I would like your vineyard. I want to make a garden, a vegetable garden. I want to grow some tomatoes and cucumbers and peppers and radishes and just, you know, a bunch of stuff. And it would be super convenient for me because I could look at it from my palace, and when I want to go weed it and stuff, take care of it, it's really close. He's all, what do you think? Listen, I will give you a piece of land, a vineyard that's better than yours, that's worth more than what this is valued at. Or if you want, I will give you the money that it's worth. Like, I won't try to, like, you know, lowball you or offer you less than your than you know, just because I'm the king. No, I'll be fair with you. I'll give you what is yours and I'll be fair with you. How's that sound? I will give you a vineyard better than it. Can you say that? Better than it. Does that sound good? Like, I would like that sometimes in my life. Something that is better than it. Like, I'm thinking, sometimes I'm like, man, I would like a car than better than it, than my car, right? Or I would like to live in an area better than it. I wouldn't mind living down by, you know, Newport Beach or something, where you can open the window every night and hear the oceans and walk out on the sand. Wouldn't that be great, living in something better than it? I haven't done that with my wife, though. I'm very happy with her. My kids sometimes, but no, I'm just kidding. Something better than it. Isn't that like we always want something better than it, right? Maybe not always, but there's times. Something better than it. So he gives him this offer. He's like, I would like to have what you have, what you value. I would like to have that, and I'm going to give you something of equal value. And it says here, in verse 3, that Naboth said to Ahab, he's courageous. He's telling Ahab, who's an evil ruler, a king, who's married to a pretty interesting woman, Jezebel, who's an evil demon-worshipping queen, literally. Her father was originally a priest of Baal, and Astrid, and she's the daughter, and she helped introduce that into the worship of the Israelites and drew their hearts away from God. She is a schemer. And Ahab was told by Naboth, "The Lord forbid that I should give you my inheritance." It's all God. And God sees, and God forbid that I give you my inheritance that was given to me by my fathers. He was committed to the family, maybe to the vineyard, maybe committed to honoring God, because in scripture, in the laws, it says you weren't supposed to sell the land the Lord gave you. You were supposed to keep it and tend it and take care of it. You could lease it if you had to, but after a certain period of time, you'd get it back. And Naboth is like, I can't, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to give you what has value to me, my inheritance of great value. And so in that verse, he says, I'm not going to surrender to you what has great value to me. I'm committed to this because he was committed to the promise of God. When the Lord said to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, I will give you this land, it was a promise from the Lord. And can you imagine, like, the Lord's like, well, I'm going to give you this thing in your life. I'm going to give you this child, this wife, whatever it is, this husband. And you know it's from the Lord. And then you're just like, yeah, I'll trade it for something else. I'm not committed to what God has given me. Naboth's like, I'm not going to do that. No. So verse 4. So Ahab went into his house sullen and displeased because of the word which Naboth the Jezreelite had spoken to him. For he said, I will not give you the inheritance of my father. So what did Ahab do? He lay down on his bed. He turned away his face. He would not eat food. But Jezebel, his wife, came to him and said to him, why is your spirit so sullen? Like, why are you so down and bummed, depressed, that you eat no food? So he tells her what happened. Because I spoke to Naboth the Jezreelite and said to him, give me your vineyard for money, or else, if it pleases you, if you want to, I will give you another vineyard. Remember, he said one that would even be better for it. And he answered, Naboth answered, I will not give you my vineyard. Ahab wanted him to surrender. He wanted Naboth to surrender what was valuable to him, his commitment, his relationship to God, his relationship to the land, to the promises of God. So Ahab goes home to his palace. He's grumpy. He's upset because things didn't go his way. I mean, he's the king. It's interesting that he just didn't, like, kill Naboth and say, I'm taking your land. But he was a king of Israel, and Jezebel's wife, she was not an Israelite. She was an ungodly person that married into the Israelite family. So maybe he still had a little bit of fear of God in him, but his wife had no fear of God in her. Jezebel was a queen, the daughter of Ithbal, king of Sidon. He was a priest of Baal and Ashtoreth. When you look at Easton's Bible Dictionary, it says Ashtoreth was frequently associated with the name of Baal. When people hear the name of Jezebel, they often associate it with the figure from the Bible who is notorious for wickedness, defiance of God. She was the one that threatened Elijah after he had sacrificed on Mount Carmel. She was a powerful woman. She knew what she wanted, and she could help you get what you wanted too. So Ahab was a weak leader, a weak man, and he was easily influenced by a strong leader, his wife. And we need to be careful, the people that we surround ourselves by. We can be easily influenced in this world. We can be easily influenced by the philosophy of this world about things, about life, about, you know, well, little boys can be little girls, and little girls can be little boys, and all these things. And we start getting, sometimes you get like, what's going on? But he was easily influenced by her. So she says what to do in verse 7. You now exercise authority over Israel. Arise, eat food. Let your heart be cheerful. I'll give you the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite. Verse 8. And she wrote letters in Ahab's name and sealed them with his seal and sent the letters to the elders and the nobles who were dwelling in the city of Naboth. And she wrote in the letter saying, proclaim a fast and seat Naboth with high honor among the people, and seat two men, scoundrels, before him to bear witness against him, saying, you have blasphemed God and the king, and then take him out and stone him so that he can die. So this is what she does. She, either with Ahab's knowledge or not, probably with his knowledge, she forges a letter in his name. She takes his signet and stamps it so it's official, and she sends it to the city in Jezreelite right there, and tells, it says, elders and nobles what to do. You know, just because we've been around, or we're a leader, or we're considered noble, we have to be that thing. We can't just have a title in our lives. We have to be and act what we say we are. Because these people went through with what she said, and this is what she said. She said, proclaim a fast and sit Naboth with high honor among the people. In other words, declare a religious gathering, a fast, and put Naboth there with all the important people. Make him feel important and put him there. Poor Naboth, you know, this guy, I don't know what he was thinking. He was committed to value, to what God had given him, to the promises of God. He was definitely committed. But I think he maybe gave in a little bit. I don't wonder if he gave in a little bit to, like, flattery and, like, oh, yeah, I'll go there. And then he's with the important people, like, oh, okay, maybe the Lord's blessing me for my commitment to him, you know, for not giving in. And that may not be what happened, but all I'm going to say about that is the Bible says charm is deceitful and beauty is vain. We need to be careful, because sometimes we might feel like we're getting lifted up, and sometimes it might just be a way for the enemy to pull the rug out from under us. You know? If you're being honored in a certain way for something you've done or whatever, take that. It's okay. You know, give glory to God. But don't, we mustn't let pride puff us up. And I'm not saying Naboth had that, but, you know, I wonder what he was thinking when he was sitting there. And so what happened? They did what she said in verse 11. So the men in the city and the elders and nobles who were inhabitants of the city did as Jezebel had sent to them, as it was written in the letters which she had sent them. They proclaimed the fast and seated Naboth with high honor among the people. I wonder if they sat in there and said, this isn't in scripture, but this is Naboth, and Ahab came to him and said, I would like your land, and Naboth, tell us what happened. You know, he's like, no, I'm not going to give the land. I don't know what he did, but man, they were sure puffing up the situation and just making him feel at ease and putting him in high honor there. In verse 13, it says, and two men, they were scoundrels. They were bad guys. They came in and sat before him, and the scoundrels witnessed against him, against Naboth. They came in. And it says they accused Naboth. They witnessed against him in the presence of the people, saying, Naboth, you blaspheme God and the king. They started falsely accusing him of not being committed to God. They were accusing him of blaspheming the God of Israel. False accusations. Aren't those some of the worst sometimes? You know, if somebody says something to you that's true and you know it's true, you're like, man, I messed up. I'm sorry, you're right. What I said. I think the day I was talking to my daughter and she goes, like, I think we were working on some worship. And I think she said something like kind of scratchy. Like the way you spoke to us was a little harsh. And man, I couldn't deny it. I was like, I'm sorry. You're right. I was scratchy with you. I was like prickly. I'm sorry. Sorry for doing that. You know? But if somebody accuses you of doing wrong and you didn't do it, who in here is going to defend themselves? Yeah, like, I didn't do that. Like, if I did it, I would say I did it, but I did not do that. You know? I didn't blaspheme God. I didn't do these things. But Naboth, it says what they did, they followed the law of God. They used religion, the law of God, against him. They took him out and killed him. They stoned him. So then in verses 11 and 12, it says that they sent to Jezebel and told her what happened. They said, we did what you said. So without Naboth knowing, he had done the right thing. He had committed himself. But there was a battle that he was unaware of behind the scenes. And I believe that's the way it is for you and I. We're like Naboth. We're trying to be committed to the Lord, to his promises, to our inheritance, our eternal inheritance, to honoring our God, you know, to honoring our family, our faith. But there's a battle sometimes that's unseen. In 1 Peter 5:8, it says that Satan is roaring around like a lion, looking to see who he could eat up and mess up and devour. We know that Jesus said, the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. So we need to be aware of that. Just because we are committed and we do the right thing, the enemy oftentimes will come in and try to discourage us and hurt us and mess us up when we're least expecting it. So we need to be aware of that. So what happened? Verse 15, and it came to pass when Jezebel heard that Naboth had been stoned and was dead, that Jezebel said to Ahab, what'd she say to him? She's all, happy anniversary, babe. I just got you a new garden. For Naboth is not alive, but dead. It's interesting to me because I don't even know if Ahab knew what Jezebel did. I mean, it's possible he didn't even know. She just says Ahab is not alive, but dead. But he may have known too. Verse 16, so it was when Ahab heard that Naboth was dead that Ahab got up and went down to take possession of the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite. So Ahab got what he wanted, and he went and took this land. Verse 17, then the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite, saying, arise, go down to meet Ahab, king who lives in Samaria. There he is in the vineyard of Naboth, where he has gone down to take possession of it. You shall speak to him. Thus says the Lord, you have murdered and also taken possession, and you shall speak to him, saying, thus says the Lord, in the place where the dogs lick the blood of Naboth, dogs shall lick your blood, even yours. And then Elijah went to him, verse 20. So Ahab said to Elijah, you have found me, O my enemy. God sees all. Naboth did die. Because even for followers of Christ, it doesn't always go our way. There's disappointments sometimes. There's things that happen in our lives. There's failures and hurt. There's times where the Lord answers prayer and we don't die to being, you know, stoned. We overcome, but there's times where, I mean, you guys, saints, suffer. Christians suffer. And Jesus said that. But God sees, because he says, I see that Ahab is in the vineyard of Naboth. Why? Because what happens when you follow the Lord and you trust in him as your God? As Christians, when we trust in Jesus, God, what happens? We have salvation. We live eternally. Like when Moses and Elijah appeared on the mount with Jesus. Naboth, though in his body was dead, he was not dead in spirit. He lives for eternity because he trusts in the Lord. It says it was still Naboth's vineyard. The Lord sees all. And then he saw what Ahab did too. And he saw that he had murdered somebody and he had stolen. In Psalm, it says the eyes of the Lord are against the wicked. And in 1 Peter 3, it says that the eyes of the Lord support the righteous. God sees your life, guys. He sees our lives. He sees all. He sees. He sees. He knows. That wasn't the end of Naboth. He lives on. And so Elijah tells him what he did in verse 20. It says, because you have sold yourself to do evil in the sight of the Lord, I will bring calamity on you. He tells Ahab, because you have been evil, you have been selfish, you've been committed to yourself. He's all, you murdered. You're going to die and dogs are going to lick your blood. You've been committed to calamity. You are going to die and suffer. This part just blows my mind. Look at verse 25. But there was no one like Ahab who sold himself to do wickedness in the sight of the Lord, because Jezebel, his wife, stirred him up. It says that there was no one like Ahab who sold himself to do wickedness in the sight of the Lord. I'm like, Ahab is done. That's it. He is done. Sometimes you might feel like you're done. Lord, I'm too messed up. I struggle. My kids are done. There's no way they can come back, Lord. This, our state is done. Our country is lost. This world is messed up and has blasphemed you and turned their backs on you. Ahab is wicked. Verse 26, and he behaved very abominably in following idols. And so the curse comes, the judgment comes. What you sow is what you will reap. The wicked King Ahab, for this time in his life, because later he chooses to go back to what he was doing. But verse 27 says this. So after Elijah pronounced judgment on him and told him what a creep he was, what a scoundrel he was weak, he was a murderer, he was a thief, he allowed, you know, wicked worship into Israel. Verse 27, after Ahab heard these things, it says, So it was when Ahab heard those words, he tore his clothes and put sackcloth on his body, and he fasted and lay in sackcloth and went about mourning. You remember in the beginning, he didn't get what he wanted, so he was mourning and he was sad and sullen. And now the Lord said, you got what you wanted, and this is who you are, and this is the judgment. And when Ahab heard this for a moment in his time, something happened in his heart, and he realized that's who he was. And he tore his clothes. He put sackcloth and ashes on. He fasted and he was mourning. The wicked King Ahab humbled himself in the sight of the Lord. James 4 tells us, humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. Draw near to God, you sinners, and he will draw near to you. I mean, is there any hope for such wickedness? Is there any hope for others? Is there any hope for us, for you and me? Verse 28, and the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite, said, this is the Lord speaking, see how Ahab has humbled himself before me? He's, look at Ahab. He was so, and now look at him. He's humble. He humbled himself. It wouldn't last forever because we have choices we make. But at this time, God's heart was turned towards this wicked king. It says, God says, because he has humbled himself before me, I will not bring the calamity in his days. I won't give him what he deserves. I will show mercy and grace, number 5, to him, towards the humble. God is willing to forgive, but we must accept it and receive it and humble ourselves. It says that in the days of his son, I will bring calamity on his house. Why? Not because God isn't merciful and gracious. It's because we sow what we reap. There has to be a price paid. What about you and I? Jesus, like Naboth, was murdered for you and I. He took that for us. He took the penalty so we could have full grace and mercy because of what he has done for us. I hope you're encouraged tonight. I love this chapter. It's just crazy to me how the Lord showed so much grace and mercy towards somebody that I don't think deserved it. But maybe that's you and me tonight, and maybe that's somebody else. God loves them, you know. He loves you. I'm going to ask Brother Daniel to come up. He's going to close. Thank you guys for your attention tonight. Pray the Lord will bless you.
Thank you, Brother Regis. That's a good lesson in the Word of God. That God is merciful in spite of ourselves. He really is. And God speaks to us in a way that He guides our lives. Sometimes we don't listen right here, and we make mistakes, but God, again, is merciful. You know, what gets in the way sometimes is the eye. Just like when Lucifer fell, he was an angel, and the 5 eyes that he was going to put himself above the Lord, I will ascend, I will exalt, I will ascend above the heights, I will be like the Most High. You know, he was just lifting himself up. No humbleness. You know, and sometimes God wants us to humble ourselves. The cost of serving, sometimes it's we seem to think that it's more difficult than it may be, but God is the one that we look to see us through that. It's not going to be with our own strength to do the work of the Lord. And you think about the apostles. I mean, they serve God. They served the Lord with all their hearts. And yet, what was their cost? They were martyred. Except for one, the Apostle John. And even they tried to kill him, but he survived. And he was exiled to the island of Patmos. But that was a blessing because that's where he wrote Revelation, the island of Patmos. You look in the Word about the Pharisee and the tax collector. The Pharisee was lifting himself, I. A tax collector standing afar off because he didn't feel worthy to stand next to a man of God, the Pharisee. But he couldn't even look up, just praising, just hitting his chest, oh Lord, forgive me, a sinner. So we learn things from the Word of God that the Lord just shows us. It's an encouraging word that Brother Reed just shared with us. And we take it to heart because we need to do that, right? Yeah, we're going to open up the altar. If anybody needs prayer, you come up. If you want to pray for yourself or a need for somebody else, somebody that's afflicted, somebody that you want to lift up tonight, we have time. We're going to pray as we worship the Lord. We're going to open up the altar. You come up and we'll pray for you. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. You come up.
Here is where I lay it down, every burden, every crown. This is my surrender.
Let's stand.
This is my surrender. Here is where I lay it down, every lie and every doubt. This is my surrender.
Do it.
whatever you want to. To do whatever you want to.
Of honor. We want to do what you want us to do, Lord, in our lives. We pray, Lord, even tonight that you bless each and everyone here, those at home. We pray for the afflicted. We pray for those who need your touch, Lord, in whatever situation they're facing today and tomorrow and the next day and the next day, Lord, whatever comes. We know you're in control, Lord. That gives us peace in our hearts and our minds, because we know that we're surrounded by a hedge of your presence. Bless your people tonight, Lord, even giving traveling mercies. You bless each one who has come here tonight, those who are at home listening to your word. We just thank you for your goodness to continue to pray for Pastor Mike. Touch him, Lord. Heal him. We ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Praise God.